In many ways, it's a tragic story. It was conceived by Pierre Carrière-Belleuse. In 1914, just a month after the war began, and he quickly enlists the aid of a friend of his and fellow painter, Auguste François Gourguet, and they enlisted the aid of 19 other painters. The painting is longer than a football field and 45 feet high. The largest painting in the world. Panoramas were like motion pictures of the 19th century. It surrounded the audience, so it made you feel like you were there at whatever was being portrayed. France, of course, would be the largest section by far, since it was a French undertaking. Smaller national sections would be dedicated to the Allies. One of the major issues that the artists faced is that they had decided to include all of the Allies. In 1917, the United States enters the war. At the very last minute, they have to completely erase one section of the painting, and they have to paint in the United States. The Panthéon was inaugurated 3 weeks before the armistice was signed. People start coming in droves almost immediately to see the painting. To my mind, it's so popular because it is able to impose meaning upon an event that was really incomprehensible. But it was obvious that people were not going to keep coming in such great numbers. The painting is rolled up, put into a specially built crate, and then loaded on to a ship to be sent to the United States. The painting arrives in New York. It was this sacred object in Paris. It gets to the United States. It's at Madison Square Garden, and then soon after that, it's in Chicago near the roller coasters. And as the war becomes more distant, it seems people are less interested in going and seeing what is being billed as the world's largest painting. The storage company decides to put the painting up for auction. Who is going to buy a long forgotten painting of a now distant war? He starts wooing the Baltimore restaurateur slash art collector, saying, "You should really give this to us in Kansas City." Hausner at first is reluctant because MacMorris tells Hausner that he will have to cut it up, essentially. and use parts of it. Hausner, finding no other takers, says that he will give it to Daniel MacMorris.
It was so badly damaged that we would have to go, from really the ground to the top of it and match paint and make corrections. Well, the first day, it turned from a job to something important. He began to explain the history of it, and that's when it began to be meaningful to me. He was going to piece it together like a jigsaw puzzle.
He decides to take the American section and make that the centerpiece of his reworked Panthéon de la Guerre. It was a French painting with its supporting allies. It's now an American representation with the Allies supporting the American World War I effort. He painted in Harry Truman. What does he do with the rest of the canvas?
He seemed to just, at the time that he was cutting on it, to just toss the pieces into a trash barrel.
And so you do have this thing preserved in part, but also eviscerated. Its original purpose, to some degree, is lost. Certainly its meaning gets changed. Had he not done it, perhaps none of it would have been saved. The vicissitudes that have accompanied the painting's journey from Great War Paris to Cold War Kansas City are a reflection of the way the war itself has been remembered, and in many cases, forgotten.